operate, what we're allowed to do in church. So if you feel comfortable with taking the old mask off, by all means, we are permitted to do so. We're happy to do so. But if not, you can leave them on as well. Our mass today is celebrated in loving memory of John Paul Repko, that is offered by daughter Cheryl. We will be having a men's club meeting after the conclusion of Holy Mass today with any men. Our YMSFR, as it is, we're looking to regroup, reform, trying to find a new direction for that. So we're looking for input from any of the guys at the parish of what you would like this group to be. Tomorrow we will have our Memorial Day services at the Sacred Heart of Jesus Cemetery on West 54th Street. I didn't check the weather. Is it good?
Yes.
It's going to be good? Okay, wonderful. So if it does something bad happen, we'll put up a sign and we'll meet here. But I'm looking forward to 10 o'clock under sunny skies at the Sacred Heart of Jesus Cemetery. Again, 10 o'clock tomorrow. This week we do serve our food ministry at 4 o'clock on Wednesday, and Thursday is the Solemnity of Corpus Christi, which means next Sunday is that wonderful fun Sunday where we conclude Holy Mass, the procession outside the exterior of the church to the four Eucharistic altars. If you remember last year, it was one of our early Masses that we had in our parking lot. We had the four tables, the altars lined up right next to the altar. This year we hope to stretch our legs and do an actual procession. So we hope that you are prepared to participate in that. With that said, today is the Solemnity of the Holy Trinity, where we honor Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I'll show it off now just because I'll be looking at it for the entire Mass. This is the Holy Trinity cross that I place upon the altar for this celebration and maybe a couple other days of the year. I love it. I think it's real cool. Of course, it has Jesus as the Son. It has the eminent God the Father behind him and the Spirit on top of the triangle, that representation of the Holy Trinity on the top there. So have this forward, we hold the Holy Trinity in our hearts, and we bless ourselves with that same Trinity to begin Holy Mass. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, so that by following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, please now kneel. Make a personal and private examination of conscience, confessing your sins before our Lord and God. Because of his mercy,
his
time, ever since God created man upon the earth, asked from one end of the sky to the other, did anything so great ever happen before? Was it ever heard of? Did a people ever hear the voice of God speaking from the midst of fire as you did and live? Or did any God venture to go and take a nation for himself from the midst of another nation? By testings, by signs, and wonders, by war, with strong hand and outstretched arm, and by great terrors, all of which the Lord your God did for you in Egypt before your very eyes. This is why you must know, and fix in your heart, that the Lord is God in the heavens above and on earth below, and that there is no other. You must keep his commandments, and his statutes and commandments that I enjoin on you today, that you and your children after you may prosper, and that you may have long life on the land, which the Lord your God is giving you forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The response to our psalm this morning is, bless the people the Lord has chosen to be his own.
Bless the people the Lord has chosen to be his own.
Upright is the word of the Lord, and all his works are trustworthy. He loves justice and right. Of the kindness of the Lord, the earth is full.
Bless the people the Lord has chosen to be his own.
By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. By the breath of his mouth, all their hosts. For he spoke, and it was made. He commanded, and it stood forward.
Bless the people the Lord has chosen to be his own.
See, the eyes of the Lord are upon those who fear him, upon those who hope for his kindness, to deliver them from death and preserve them in spite of famine.
Bless the people the Lord has chosen to be his own.
Our soul waits for the Lord, who is our help and our shield. May your kindness, O Lord, be upon us who have put our hope in you.
Bless the people the Lord has chosen to be his own.
Our second reading is from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received a spirit of adoption, through whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if only we suffer with him, so that we also be glorified with him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be in your hearts and on your lips, and you may believe and pray this holy gospel in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Blessed are you, O Lord, the God of our fathers, praiseworthy and exalted above all forever.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Approached and said to them, all power in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make the disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, until the end of the age. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Celebrating Trinity Sunday. And it serves as the last hurrah of sorts in what's been a long time, three pre-Lenten Sundays, six Lenten Sundays, seven Sundays of Easter, the great day of Pentecost. If you were adding as I put those numbers, it was 17. 17 weeks of building up, showing the first sign of the persecution of Christ to his death, to his resurrection, Pentecost, that post-Easter life. And then it's this Sunday, Holy Trinity Sunday. A Sunday that's named after a dogma, a teaching of the Church. God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit are all scriptural. We can all find the backing throughout Scripture to determine their divinity. But not once do we see in the Holy Bible the phrase Holy Trinity, or Blessed Trinity, whatever you might see. The Church collected information and studies and pieces of Scripture and put it together, determining the idea that the three gods of one person is the greatest of the Church's mysteries, Holy Trinity. I love teaching in a catechism class. Always have. So I remember the lesson vividly from when I was 7 years old learning. The priest, my dad, of course, not saying that he was the best teacher or the worst teacher, but the example he used is the one that the Church always used. If I had, let's say, Mackenzie over here as a student, and I dumped a cup of water on her hand, I would ask her, Mackenzie, what are your hands now? Wet, she said. And if I put an ice cube in her hands and told her to hold that together and hold it for a minute and afterward drop the ice cube, besides cold, your hands would be wet. And then finally, the cup of proverbial boiling water, put your hands like an inch over it so you don't get burned and leave it there for like 2 minutes. All of a sudden, you hold up your hands, they are hot and wet. She wasn't wrong. It's okay. She wasn't wrong. It's early. Now, the earliest mention of the Trinity, of course, that displays how those three very different things can be one. And of course, once you get to high school science, you learn even more about that kind of stuff. But the earliest mention of Trinity, the idea that these three are in one, was 180 AD. By Theophilus of Antioch, using the Greek word trias. Oh my gosh, there's more to this than the Bible has even revealed to us. But God's revealing more stuff to us to understand years later. And even before then, superheroes of the early church that perhaps just hold a great place in my heart and Deacon Jim's heart and all these other words are just going to be names you've never even heard before. Tertullian and Clement of Rome and Justin Martyr recognize all three of these Godheads bunched together, again, filling up this idea and building up what would be the dogma of the teaching of the Church, the Holy Trinity. The point years after the last apostle John breathed his last breath, people wanted to know more about God. We need more. How do we get more? And it took these men and women of the church as well to study, to understand, to contemplate the prayer, and to write down what would become the doctrine of the church. And not without way too much fighting. Because that's what we do well in church as well. If somebody has one idea and another, and they're both good, but there's only one result of it, boy, we like to fight. The first councils of Nicaea and Constantinople, and now you're throwing in ethnicity stuff, people from all over the place getting together to share ideas of what they think God should and could be. They get together in 325 AD in Nicaea and 381 in Constantinople. They actually agreed on something. The creed. And most of the creed that we have today, because there's still work to do, fleshing out the Holy Trinity, and it took from 325 to 381 to pretty much get word for word everything that we will be standing up and reciting in just a few moments. Fighting, studying, praying, contemplation. With all that knowledge and the brain and spirit work that went into trying to understand God, and now the church was legal in 325. And it was the church flourishing at this point. It took about 800 AD until Trinity Sunday was established, and again until the 1300s until somebody decided, the Pope of course, that it should be on the Sunday after the Pentecost, now and forever. Thus allowing all of us to be reminded of our collective Trinitarianism. We believe in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But we've always honored the Trinity. It's one of the first things we learned. Not just Mackenzie and Catechism class, but I can tell you that my son already blesses himself close enough and has for the last, I don't know, year or so. There's an idea that as we, as parents, as we embed in that church home, the idea of the Trinity, we think nothing of it. We just tell our children, there is this Holy Trinity. Bless yourself, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We don't even think about it for the vast majority of the time. Before I come out for any service, we ring these bells, ring, 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 sanctuary bells. And the last thing I say is, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end, a doxology, a short hymn of praise to that Holy Trinity. The Trinity is always on our mind, even if we're not really thinking about those words that are on the banners right there, reminding us of what it means to us. You know, I knew something I wanted to preach on Trinity Sunday some 8 or 9 weeks ago. I'll ask a rhetorical question. I'm not going to expect an answer, but if I do, gold coins for everybody here. Do you remember the last time that I, as priest, ritually sang about the Holy Trinity? Down to the top of these steps, and then we hung that turn over here. And silently, we unveiled Christ's empty grave. And silently, just with the clanking of the thurible, we blessed that, acknowledging his power over death. And the first words I sang were, glory to thee, O Trinity, co-equal. There are theology books this thick devoted to that sentence that I just said, focused on the co-equality of the Holy Trinity. But your eyes are just getting sleepy just hearing that last sentence. I know that. But with some of the history under your belt that I just stated about the Trinity, let's look at the scripture that influenced it. The second reading from St. Paul to the Romans, that we have taken on a spirit of adoption. And that means we open ourselves up as believers to that new spirituality, to love, to new facets of faith. Believers in the Holy Trinity, as we are, we've had to take great leaps of faith beyond our hands holding different forms of water when we were 7 years old. We have to believe that there's an almighty creator that snapped off that spark of life for the creation of the world, spoken about in Genesis. We have to believe that there is a divine redeemer who won our salvation via the cross across the entirety of the four gospels. And finally, the advocate whose praises we sung last week, who is divinely with us on earth forever. And you believe all of that. There is no doubt, because you wouldn't be here if all what I just said you did not believe. In about 3 minutes, we're going to stand up and recite together all the backing of what that belief means in the form of the creed that was fought upon, that was battled upon, that people were kicked out of the church for arguing about. Something that you probably know by heart as well, that creed, if I made you write it down word for word. That's the spirit of adoption, part of it that Paul speaks about. That as we increase our faith, as we stay on this earth and we grow in age, don't we grow in wisdom as well? It's not a bad thing. That's why the age of people who worship at church tends to run a little older, I suppose, than those who watch a Cleveland Indians game in person. A willingness to adopt the church as an indelible part of your life. Something that takes a little time. Something that you could not be without. In the same way, a parent adopts a child that they've accepted as their own. They cannot live without this child. It takes time to get to that point. That's why adoptive parents are often in their 40s. You know, this is the only time, the only Sunday in the year 2021, in year B, whatever we want to call it as well, that we heard from the Gospel of St. Matthew. You're not going to hear on Sunday St. Matthew's Gospel for a while, and you haven't for a while. The Solemnity of the Holy Trinity exclusively calls our ears to hear Jesus' call of the Great Commission from Matthew chapter 28. We see the 11. And Matthias hadn't been elected yet, like we heard a couple weeks ago. We see the 11 called forth by Christ. And we don't see an ascension during his final moments before he did ascend. Matthew focuses on the divinity of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit in the last few words that he has in this 28th chapter of the Gospel. And that, the Father, Son, and Spirit need to be manifested in this way, the way the apostles preach to people, and every single time somebody is baptized. Jesus mentions all three members of the Holy Trinity, and to this day, the church, capital C, accepts any single baptism that was done in the name of the Holy Trinity, whether it was by the hands of Prime Bishop Francis Hoder, or whether it was an emergency baptism done in a hospital nursery by a nurse who knows the words and knows how to do it, as long as it is done in the name of the Holy Trinity. It's what makes baptism so, so fundamentally important and universal. Because Jesus said, go and do it like this in these names, and that's it. This is how we ensure that Jesus is with us always, just like he said in the gospel. If you do what I commanded you, behold, I am with you always until the end of ages. The way we do this is echoing those words not only of Christ, but of Deuteronomy that we heard, our first reading. You must keep his statutes and commandments, which I enjoin on you today, that you and your children after you may prosper, that you may have long life in the land the Lord your God is giving you forever. Earliest scriptures, Deuteronomy, to the final call of Matthew's gospel, to heed the words of God. May we take this message, this doctrine, this dogma of the church, and heed what God has inspired the church to pass on to us. Now and forever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Of the Father.
not received the spirit of slavery, but you have received the spirit of adoption. With renewed confidence, we approach our God for what we need as God's people in God's world.
Through our brother John Paul Repko, as he exalts in heaven with Father, Son, and Spirit this day and in our prayers at Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That the Church on earth may be drawn together to reflect the perfect unity of the Trinity, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That those living in fear may find the freedom of the sons and daughters of God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those serving in our armed forces, and for veterans who have offered a portion of their lives in protection of this great nation, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Gracious God, giver of all that is good, we as members of the Polish National Catholic Church stand in awe before you, the Most Holy Trinity, ask that you send us more vocations to the Holy Priesthood. In the name of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a sense of renewal of not only spirit, but health and well-being, we offer our thoughts and prayers for God's people, Richard and Edna Samuelson, Shannon Alberino, Mary Pauley, Eugene Began, Diane Black, Emma Freshwater, Jennifer Kless, Jack Spilka, John Raven, Jim Giles, Tom Sloka, Kim Penny, Nina Brakewith, Linda Duffy, Mike Mattis, Ralph Crispino, Mike Pescatelli, Nancy Kova, Amy Dreger, Janice Balicki, Father Senior Joseph Soltysha, Shauna, Ellen Teff, Elaine Teff, for all on our prayer list, for all friends and family members, for those living in fear, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That our departed brothers and sisters may be raised into the glory of the Holy Trinity, especially John Paul Repko, for those who gave the ultimate sacrifice and service to country, for departed service men and women, for our departed family, parishioners, and friends, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The Creator God, may your name be held holy. May your kingdom come. Listen to the prayers we offer to you this day, empowered by the Holy Spirit, always, through Christ our Lord. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope. Power of the Holy
Spirit.
We ask you to make them holy. Grant us an understanding of your inner life, for to that living mystery we have been called. We ask this for our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
You break me.
free from sin and protect us from all anxiety as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ?
Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread.
May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other a sign of his peace.
Together.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
And as we prepare to receive our Lord this morning, may we now kneel as we pray together the first communion prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teachings and never let me depart from you.
I will take the bread of heaven and call upon the name of the Lord.
Lord, worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
The body of Christ bring me to everlasting life. Me to everlasting life.
This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to the table of the Lord.
And for those worshiping at home and those who choose to receive spiritually this day, we continue to offer our act of spiritual communion. Most loving Jesus, I adore you in the most blessed sacrament in which you are truly present. I love you above all things, and I long for you in my soul. Since I cannot receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart and heal my soul. I embrace you and unite myself with you. May I never be separated from you. Inflame my heart with the fire of your love, my Lord and Savior.
Thank you.
in which your mystical body becomes present with us through the sacrament, may it be for us a means to salvation and everlasting life. You have given us this bread from heaven, O Lord, that we may sweeten us.
The Holy Spirit.
Amen.
offer a blessing of this wreath and to offer Memorial Day prayers on this Sunday before Memorial Day. So let us quiet our hearts and minds before we close Holy Mass with song with this blessing. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who by whose word all things are made holy, we ask you to bless this patriotic wreath granted by PLAB Post 164. Grant that whoever uses it as we display it within our parish of St. Mary's in accordance with your holy will and your law, and in the spirit of thanksgiving, may experience by your power health of body and protection of soul, as we in this blessing invoke your holy name through Christ our Lord. Psalm 33, verse 12 says, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people chosen as his inheritance." And sisters and brothers, for as much as God has put into our hearts to provide the image of this flag displayed upon this wreath, an emblem of the United States of America, it's a reminder of the freedom enjoyed under our constitutional government, a challenge to preserve to our posterity those ideals which have their source in God, and a symbol of the nation which, under God, we love. It is fitting and proper that we should now dedicate it to him who holds the nations of the earth in the palm of his hand and set it apart for use as a symbol of our nation. To you and your service, Almighty God, we now ask you, in the name of the Holy Trinity, on whose solemnity we honor this day, to bless this wreath containing these flags, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.